We are back with Mayor Ed Koch. Mr. Mayor, I have to ask you a question. We spoke a moment ago about how you mentioned that Mubarak was thrown under the bus. Why is it, in your opinion, that the Iranian leader was untouched? And when there were popular riots in Iran, this radical leader of Iran was not criticized by America, and there was no work on the part of the United States to undermine that regime. However, the moment a moderate regime in Egypt has problems, Mubarak, for many years, as you mentioned, he's thrown under the bus. Why was that?
Well, that's a very good question. I think our policies vis-a-vis Iran have been wrong for a very long time. We deserted the Shah and allowed Khomeini, who was very anti-American, and ultimately they took our embassy hostage, and they're threatening us currently with a nuclear bomb, which they'll first use on Israel if they could, and then use on us. They said the United States could disappear. That was the language of the president of Iran. So we've had the wrong slant in terms of at any time being supportive of those regimes. And then when you ask the question of when there was a near revolution in the streets of Tehran in the last election, some people believe that the insurgents, if you will, won the election and it was stolen from them. At that time, you may remember, President Obama got the Nobel Peace Award. He hadn't done anything to get the Nobel Peace Award. It was nice. We all felt nice that the president, shortly after becoming president, received such a high award. But if he had given that award to the people of Iran who were in the streets, think of how wonderful recollections would be today. If he had said, I accept this award for the people who are struggling in the streets of Tehran. Now, President Obama has declared war on Libya, declared war on Yemen. We're now in four wars, Afghanistan and Iraq. And it's bleeding us physically in blood. While the president said many, many months ago that military activities had ceased in Iraq, they're still killing our soldiers there. They were killed a number this week. I think this month is the highest casualty rate for the United States and for the UN soldiers who are allied with us who are there. So he was wrong on that. And now he, as I understand it, would like us to stay even longer, to 2014 and maybe beyond that, in Iraq and Afghanistan. It's wrong. It's not only, for example, costing us $2 billion a week for military activities in Afghanistan, but we are losing the lives of young men and women and many more who are terribly disfigured from casualties of war. And it's for what? To do that, to give up our blood, the lives of our people, and our treasure to support a corrupt government, Karzai's government. Everybody says is corrupt. And he also has already announced he's going to take in the Taliban as the collaborators in his government. We went into Afghanistan to get rid of al-Qaeda. The former CIA director, Leon Panetta, I think said al-Qaeda currently has something like 20, maybe a max of 50 operatives. We have in Afghanistan 93,000 American troops to get rid of 20 to 50 operatives. And we're fighting, of course, the Taliban. But the Taliban will soon be a part of the Afghanistan government. So what are we achieving? Nothing. And we're supporting the so-called Arab Spring. Do we know what these people will do when they come into power, whether it's in Tunis or Libya or Yemen? If you look historically, they're not going to be better than the ones who were there. They'll be the same or worse, and not friendly to the United States.
Sir, I'm very tempted to speak more about Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, the leader of Iran, but let's talk about issues here in the United States. What are your thoughts with regard to the economy?
We are going through very difficult times in the United States, but we will prevail. This is not a situation like Greece, where, as I heard a commentator say, Greece is asking for help. We're not asking for help. We're the predominant nation economically, even though everybody talks about China. China's gross national product is about a third of ours, and it is doing fantastically well. I don't want to take away from it. But we are still the premier nation, and nations throughout the world, Europe in particular, think about us as their protector. And we're happy to do that, whether we're Democrats or Republicans. But they have to do more, and they have to be more supportive of the United States. When we went into Afghanistan, very few of our NATO allies went in with us. And what they did, England was the largest supporter. We have like 100,000 people there. They have about 10,000 people there. All the other is very small, and they're all rushing for the exits, as they say. So I don't think that our allies, and NATO in particular, have been particularly supportive of us as we have been of them. And then you have the United Nations, which is turning into a criminal institution run by the third world countries, with the countries, industrial countries in Europe, and worried that if they vote against Arab motions that are hostile to Israel and unfair to Israel, that they, the Arabs, will somehow or other cut or reduce or eliminate the oil supplies of the European countries and Japan that need that oil. Well, things are even changing there because we now have found in the United States natural gas, which I was told the quantities are double what Saudi Arabia has by way of equivalency in oil. Now, if that's true, and if we're able to develop it, we'll no longer be giving our billions of dollars. I think we give to the OPEC countries something close to $500 billion a year in buying OPEC oil. That money would be spent here in NAFTA and Canada, Mexico, the United States. So that would be much more helpful to us. But as I say, like every other country, we're going through hard times, but we will prevail.
Mr. Mayor, before we end, I'd like to comment on your history. You've been in Congress for many terms, the mayor of New York City, and recently you wrote this book. What are your plans for the future?
I am in my 87th year, and I hope that I will die at my desk whenever God wants to take me. And that I will be relevant and active until I leave the earth. I enjoy working. I have passions for particular areas of concern. Israel is one of my great concerns. I'm never going to go on aliyah. I'm an American citizen. This country has given me everything. I was a member of the city council. I was a congressman for 9 years, a mayor for 12 years. They just named a bridge after me, the Ed Koch Queensborough Bridge. So I owe this city, this state, this country so much, and I'm very grateful. Figuratively, I ought to be kissing the ground every night, if not actually. And yet, I know that in the period pre and during World War II, there were no countries that took large numbers of Jews, including the United States. They were turned away. They died. They were killed. 6 million of them. Had there been a strong state of Israel, it would have taken every, at that time, it would have taken every Jew, no matter how infirm, no matter how old, no matter how poor. And that is why I feel so strongly about the state of Israel. And so I will continue to write about that issue and the domestic issues that we face here in the United States on Social Security and Medicare and Medicaid. It's a great country. That's why everybody wants to come here.
Sir, this has been a great privilege. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Today. Thank you, sir. I'll be right back. This brings us to the end of our special show for today from On Location in New York City with Mayor Ed Koch. I'm Richard Peritz. Thank you for being with us.